Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CEC Edisit Live Lecture. Dear friends, as you know that from time to time, we talk on different topics, and with the help of these topics, we feel so, we help you out in studying your course material, as well as we believe that we enlighten your knowledge, we enlighten your ability to read and to know certain characters, to know certain people. Dear friends, in this session today, we would be discussing on Shakespeare's one of the another literary creation, that is Macbeth. Macbeth is the creation what you might have learnt about, read about, and if not, dear friends, I believe that from this lecture onwards, you are going to read the Macbeth, as well as you are going to get deep insight into the creation of Shakespeare, that is Macbeth. And for this, dear friends, we have again with us in our studios Professor Anand Prakash. Professor Anand Prakash is a retired professor from the Department of English, University of Delhi, and I say with the help of these EduSit platform, he reaches to our heart, because the way he used to deliver his lectures, he creates curiosity in us to read all the characters, to read all the writers. So without wasting any time, first of all, I would like to welcome our guest Professor Anand Prakash, as well as I would like to welcome our new academic coordinator Dr. Unnati Gulati, who is participating with us in this lecture, because in the other half, or at the last 10 minutes, we would be discussing about Macbeth after getting deep insight from Professor Anand Prakash. So first of all, I would like to welcome our guest Professor Anand Prakash. Hello sir, welcome to the EduSit lecture.
Thank you Geetika for your kind words, and I also welcome Unnati to this discussion, and welcome viewers. Today's topic is Shakespeare's Macbeth, and we have done already two tragedies of Macbeth. Shakespeare is known as a writer of tragedies more than other kinds of plays that he wrote in the latter part of the 16th and early 17th century. This play belongs to the first decade of the 17th century, and this is a part of that phase when Shakespeare is supposed to have a very dark mood. He became a person of a very dark mood in the early part of the 17th century. I wouldn't like to go into the details about why he became so very pessimistic, so very tragic, so very sad about potentialities of human life and social behavior. I'll not go into that, but we will try to capture the mood of sadness, the mood of tragedy, the mood of destruction, death, and violence, as reflected in this play. And that's a kind of, a point that, one has always to keep in mind in order to comprehend the range and depth of Shakespeare's dark emotions, so to say. Macbeth, as I said, belongs to the first decade of the 17th century, and that is the period in England of instability. England is not as sure of itself as it was, in the latter half of the 16th century, when Queen Elizabeth ruled for a long time. And in 1603, the Queen dies, and then, there is a kind of, problem regarding who will govern the country, who will rule the country. And this time the King will be imported from another part of England and from a different family. And people are apprehensive about the, background of faith, the background of religion, the background of, a set of ideas that the new king will adhere to. Elizabeth was, closer to and sympathetic with, Protestantism of a sort. I say of a sort because she was more English than Protestant. Protestantism was a movement, that traveled from one country to another in Europe in the 16th century. English people as a nation, they use Protestantism to collect, accumulate resources. And it was really very lucrative to become a Protestant, because then, the land of the church, which was Roman Catholic, that land will pass on under the control of the king or the queen. And because land was a very important factor, and it was the basis of agriculture in England, so a lot of money will flow into the coffers of the king, just because the land came from the church to the secular ruler, the ruler of this world itself. So that was the background of money that was involved. I don't want to go into the history of it, but I tell you that these factors become very important in the context of ruling a country, to giving it stability, to giving it a kind of governance. And Elizabeth was to a large extent successful in taking these resources in her hands and taking the country onto a path of progress and what is called economic development. But towards the end of the 16th century, when the queen was getting old and when she was nearing her death, and people were apprehensive that something untoward might happen in England with the passing away of the queen. So the mood was building up of uncertainty and a kind of sadness and pessimism in England at that time. And Shakespeare may have been affected. Nobody knows for sure as to what Shakespeare had felt at that time. But he must be always thinking of an unbright future in England at that time. And perhaps he was overtaken by this mood when he wrote these plays, which are called tragedies. Great writers do not reflect their time as mechanically as some others do. Great writers always grasp the reality of their time, then make it a part of their understanding and their sensibility, and then they write out. Then they take pen in their hand, paper in their hand, then they compose poems, they compose plays, and they present them on the stage. So Shakespeare would be doing all these things and then writing Macbeth. We have discussed, viewers, so far two great tragedies of Shakespeare. One was King Lear, the other was Hamlet. And I would say that so far as King Lear was concerned, the king was not very much at fault. He was 80 years and his two daughters, who initially took away all the power that he had. Of course, he gifted the power to them. But her daughter, who was he very, very fond of, that daughter spoke the truth to the king, and the king didn't take the truth. And therefore, all those things happened in King Lear. So I would not blame King Lear for being a tragic hero for his own conduct. He might have made some mistake. He might have been a bit foolish. And that, made him, face the circumstances that unfolded in England. So far as Hamlet is concerned, Hamlet, is not as revengeful as would be thought. He is not very violent in nature. He is always exploring. Of course, there are deaths and there are killings in the play, and Hamlet's at certain moments becomes very ruthless. But Hamlet basically is a reflective person, a person who would think twice before taking a step, and very intelligent. He talks to himself. He goes through a kind of mental tussle, and he approaches wisdom. Therefore, we like him. Hamlet is one of the most likable characters in Shakespeare, even though he's a tragic hero. But when we come to Macbeth, then we realize that the world is not easy to tackle, and the world is not easily to exist in. It's not easy, for instance, to take stock of the circumstances that an individual faces. And the person starts taking a step which is against his conduct, which is against his value system, and which is the least expected of a great a military figure and a social figure as Macbeth. But then Shakespeare shows this person bringing about his own downfall, bringing about his own destruction, bringing about his own moral death. He kills himself morally. He does something that he doesn't like to do, and yet he does it. Why? This is the question that is posed right in the beginning. Now, before I'll also do in this play a discussion about certain characters who take part in the goings on that are shown by the playwright. And the kind of dangerous, deadly duo that Macbeth makes with his wife. So one doesn't know who is more cruel, whether Macbeth is more cruel, Macbeth is more violent, or his wife is more violent. And Shakespeare is going into the heart of the matter. He's not showing a woman as a soft person, as we generally associate women with sweetness, with imagination, with kindness, with motherhood, with all those things, the wifely love, the beloved's love, all those things. So we think women as very, very soft creatures, soft human species, which is not the case so far as this play is concerned. In fact, at some points of time when Macbeth has, a kind of a doubt about his own conduct, about his own, immoral, if not immoral ways. Then it is she who holds her his hand and says, "No, you have to go forward because you decided earlier to be violent." So here we have a very dangerous combination of a great fighter, a great military figure as Macbeth, and his wife, who eggs him on, who encourages him to destroy, to remain firm in his commitment to death and destruction. So Shakespeare is able to explore, the inner layers of the mind of a woman who is called Lady M or Lady Macbeth. And he has blood on his hands. She also has blood on her hands. And he wants to wash the blood off his hands. She also wants to do it. But then at one point of time in the play, she says that the entire scent of Arabia will not be able to take the bad smell of blood from her hands. So she says this to herself. At that time, she is doing a kind of a dream walking. So we have these characters plus others in the play. So I'll keep this in mind while discussing this play. And secondly, I'll tell you that all told, it's a very humanist document, in spite of the fact that the hero is a destroyer, the hero is a murderer, the hero is an assassin, and he has a great help, from his wife. And yet, when Shakespeare is showing these people in those details, and then, bringing about their own downfall, and they die, then we realize that, it's a kind of a humanist document that emerges. We start searching our own souls. Isn't some kind of, violence ingrained in our own behavior? Will we not be as ruthless as Macbeth and his wife when we are faced with the challenge of temptation, for instance? And Macbeth starts with a temptation. But then, let me also tell you about the plot before I go into the discussion. In the beginning, there are three, women, and they are called witches, and they are spotted by Macbeth and his friend somewhere in the forest. And these figures, appear before him, and they say certain things to him, and then they disappear. What do they say? Well, they predict, that at some point of time, Macbeth is going to become the king. And Macbeth is not the king. Somebody else is the king at the moment. So this idea enters the head of Macbeth. And, they also say that initially Macbeth will be given control over one more state of the country. And within a few minutes on the stage, Macbeth realizes that control has come under him, because a messenger comes from the king and says, "Now you will be controlling that particular part of the country also." And so the one prediction is that Macbeth will become more important than before, and he will become the controller of the state, and that proves to be true. And the second prediction, prophecy, that the witches make is that finally Macbeth will become the king. There is also a third prophecy made by these women, who are there in the forest, and one doesn't know where they came from and where they might be disappearing into. But then they come forward and make the third prediction. And the third prediction is that the person standing next to, Macbeth will not be a king himself, but his children will become the king. One of the children will become the king. So it's a very strange kind of wish. Two people are caught, in this kind of a web of temptation. And are these women real? Shakespeare doesn't want to tell this to the audience. He says they appeared before him, and they appeared and they said this, and this caught the imagination of the hero or the protagonist. So this is how the play begins, and then the first prediction comes true in the first 5-10 minutes or so. The area of influence of Macbeth spreads. And then he says, "Well, I have to take these people seriously, because one of the prophecies has come true." And then, he writes this to his wife, who also takes, agreeing with him. And she starts dreaming, that if the husband becomes the king, then she will be the queen. And how to tackle the present king? And later on, when the king has become their guest, the king is happy, you know, that Macbeth has fought and defended his territories. So the king says, okay, I'll come to your place and, you know, I'll stay there for a day. And then, you know, we can chat also. He's very happy with Macbeth. And Macbeth, in the meantime, in association with his wife, has decided to kill the king in the night. And later on, you know, when the king is dead, then the authority will pass on to Macbeth, because he is next in command in the affairs of the country at the ruling level. Macbeth has committed an act of, assassination, an act of murder. Therefore, he has to now wipe out the evidence of that murder. And that takes him further into the more killing. And one killing follows another, and later on, he cannot, you know, forget all these things. The effect of all these events on his mind, and he starts, you know, facing himself, much more, you know, mystically and morally, etc. And finally, he thinks that life is not worth living or something, and he's taken. He's finally dead, and makes the scene clear for the third prophecy, that the friend's, you know, child will become the king. And in the meantime, Macbeth has also got the friend killed, and also attempted, you know, on the life of the friend's son. But that son, you know, at some point of time disappeared from the scene. And when Macbeth dies, then that son comes back. So in a way, it's a question about prophecy which comes out to be true. So the plot has been given right in the beginning of the play, and then, you know, the issues of many kinds relating to life, they emerge in the mind of the audience, and they emerge, you know, in the play itself. So it is these issues, you know, which for me are important. It is because of these issues, you know, that I say it's a humanist document. We start thinking about the areas which remain suppressed in our mind, and when they are given a chance, when a fertile, you know, soil is there in society, at that point of time, those seeds of destruction, those seeds of evil, those seeds of oppressing people and being cruel, those seeds, you know, they sprout, and to extend the metaphor, finally the whole thing is covered by the trees that were, you know, that came into being because of the seeds that were buried deeper into the consciousness of the person. So this is the plot that I have outlined, friends, for your benefit, so that you can, you know, follow the points that I make. And I will keep on, you know, stressing this point, that because the play is dark, the play shows violence in its true color, the color of blood, the color of the color red. Therefore, we are compelled to think about the consequences of our own actions in life. So when I read Macbeth, when you read Macbeth, then you realize that there is something inside you, there is something inside me, which is evil. And that evil, you know, will control the entire consciousness and compel us to go onto the wrong path. And when you know about the wrong path, you also know about the right path. So when you criticize Macbeth, you also criticize yourself, I also criticize myself, and finally there is a possibility that we'll remain aware and conscious of the possibilities of evil in us, and we'll try to control, and who knows, maybe we succeed, we become fine human beings. So that, you know, a humanist paradigm, that humanist perspective of goodness, when you are face to face with evil, that is very, very strongly established in the play. And that's what I call a humanist document that this play is. And this is to take us in the direction of Shakespeare's own perspective of humanism. Shakespeare would not indulge in violence, will not show violence indulgently, you know, the way modern, you know, films show. You start enjoying violence. Here, when, you know, you see violence, when the characters, you know, take part in the violent acts, and when they see violence in front of them, then they feel nauseated. When you watch the play on the stage, or this play has been filmed by a large number of people in different languages. I saw one version of Japanese film, and that was remarkable for its imagination range. And Kurosawa, the great, you know, director, had made the film on this play. And the film was called Throne of Blood. So he gave a different title. He didn't say Macbeth. Shakespeare wouldn't bother about the title, but Kurosawa gave this his title, the Throne of Blood. And then, of course, the rest is the plot, and he interprets the plot that way. So when you watch that film, when you watch Macbeth on the stage, then you feel, you know, very bad about, you have a kind of feeling that if this is what life is, then what is the worth of living it? And unless, you know, we create conditions in which we flower, in which we fulfill ourselves, there is no need to live on. So this is the kind of message that gets across to us, and it is this, you know, that makes this play very appealing. Now, place this play in the context of the 16th, 17th century England. Now, which place in Europe or which place in England would be, you know, comparable with the requirements of this play? This play can't be placed in England, in London, because England is the seat of Renaissance at that point of time. There are many crudities and all, but England also has cities, England also has scholars. England also has, you know, great thinkers at that time. I've given already, you know, presented discussions for you, friends, about Thomas More, who was 50 years before Shakespeare was there on the scene, and Chaucer before that. So one can't think of this kind of a crude violence, the scope of crude violence being shown against the background of England. So where should Shakespeare place this play? This is the question. And Shakespeare, you know, has a very big range of interests, very big range of knowledge, and, you know, he placed this play in Scotland, and he picked up this tale in Scotland, and there is blood and gore, and Scotland even today happens to be, in terms of economy and politics, less forward, less modern than the rest of England. So this play is based in Scotland. So Macbeth is a Scottish protagonist in the play, and this kind of, you know, change of government, change of the king, change of the court, change of the of control of you know, affairs in the country, that would be imaginable more in Scotland than in England at that time. It's a different thing that the reference to England comes. The reference to Ireland also comes. Now the two sons of the present king, who is murdered by Macbeth initially. Those two sons, run to two different parts of England. One goes to to Ireland, the other goes to England, and they are assassinated there. So, England is there. Scotland is at the center, but England also is there. So, which means that you can't separate one place from another. But then, if you are focusing upon Scotland, then you are focusing upon violence of a different kind. So the role of Scotland also is important. There is a tale, there is a folk tale, and these folk tales are there in all languages. And Shakespeare was using the folk tale. In fact, just on the sides, I will tell you that Shakespeare never, you know, imagined and never, you know, formulated a completely independent plot. He always borrowed plot from others. And this plot is borrowed, for instance, from a Scottish folk tale. So there is a folk tale there. There are certain characters there. There is a character called Macbeth, and Shakespeare is rewriting this folk tale in the dramatic form, and then he is presenting these humanist ideas, as I call them again and again. Which are the issues that you know get raised in the play, in the context of this kind of a plot, and in this kind of a frame, you know, that Shakespeare evolves in the course of presenting the play on the stage. And let me give you a view of the, you know, issues that will emerge. One issue would be of power. And the moment you think of power, you think of becoming a king in today's conditions, becoming a minister, becoming, you know, the person who will govern the country, etc. And political power that way always engaged the attention of the audience very strongly. And particularly, as I told you in the beginning of the discussion, English people were thinking of the change of forces at the center, in the court, at the level of the king, and they were apprehensive. So the question of the power struggle was uppermost in the minds of the English audience at that point of time, and Shakespeare must exploit this particular concern of the people, that it's a power struggle. So there is a kind of a power struggle that is seen in the play. The second thing that is courtly conflicts. Court is not united under one king. There must be different lobbies in the court, among the courtiers, among the nobility, among the aristocracy. And these people would always be active vis-a-vis, you know, their subjects, vis-a-vis one another, so that, you know, they want a king to their own liking. So maybe there are certain lobbies which are working from behind the newly emerging center of power, which is Macbeth. So it's not merely that two individuals are fighting, the king and Macbeth. It is also that the lobbies, the sections of people who also want a share in the pie, who want also the share in the order of things, these people are also contending for, are also competing for influence at the level of politics. So you can see that happening. There are certain characters who support Macbeth. There are certain others who support Duncan, who's the present king when the play opens. And there are certain forces, particularly those forces, you know, which are not in the power game, who would be thinking differently. I'll take this question of the third force, which is of the masses. And maybe those women, those three women, they came from the masses. And it is these people, you know, who can predict. In fact, in passing, let me also tell you that masses are never passive. If you think that masses are passive, then you have to rethink your position, because they're always observing. Maybe they don't have the guts to come forward and take things in their own hands and to change the course of life, that they change the course of history. Maybe they don't have that power, but they're always apprehensive. They're always alert. They're always conscious. They're always eager to know. And they would raise questions. And if those questions are not allowed to be raised, then those questions will remain all the time, traveling in their mind from one corner to another, so to say. So who are the masses here? Where are they? Well, I would guess, you know, the masses are there in these three women. And these three women have been, thrown out of the city, thrown out of the town, thrown out of the village also. And how come that only women are thrown out of the town? It's a question that, you know, women audience, you know, among the listeners, they would like to reflect. They are thrown out. They are outcasts. Who will feed them? What will they eat in the forest? What are they doing in the forest? And what do they look like? They are all old hags. They must be 60 plus, 70 plus, etc. And they have no flesh on their body. They are just skin and bone. And they don't even talk, you know, correctly or audible. Well, they can shout, but, you know, they can't be, you know, comprehended properly. And they dance around. And who are these women? Now, of course, there is feminist scholarship in the latter part of the 20th century, and there are feminists active in the field of literature today also. They say that these are the women who are called witches. Witches means that they practice magic. And why should they press magic? Because they have no role to play in real life. So they can play a role only in magical, context. So they have taken to magic, and they are shunned by people. And if you go into the English history of the time, you will realize that these witches were caught from wherever they were active. They were caught and burnt on the stake, and for just practicing magic. So practicing magic was illegal in England at that point of time. And Shakespeare is presenting these women as dangerous portents of things to come. So he is in a way telling us that, well, these women are prophesying. And maybe they are wrong. But who knows, maybe they are correct. After all, magic also can have some kind of influence on life. Magic has no scientific foundation, has no scientific basis. And Shakespeare is writing in the times of Renaissance, when people are, you know, studying the world as it is, not through the eyes of any idea or religion or morality. He's looking at the world with the naked eye. And when, you know, there's a scientific temper is emerging in England, then, you know, these witches who are supposed to come from Scotland or who are active in Scotland, these witches are focused upon by the king. So I would say that they are not witches. They're actual women. This is what feminist scholars also say. They're actual women who have been discarded by their children, by their families, and they can't fend for themselves. So out of helplessness, they have taken to magic, and they move around in the forests, and they are at the mercy of wild animals. Who knows where they live at night, etc. So they appear in the play again and again, and they always, you know, misguide the hero, so to say. But I would ask the question, you can't, you know, blame the person who misguides. You have to blame the person who takes the guidance. And the person who takes the guidance is the person who is actually one of the most important figures in the play. So the third dimension also is there. that the dimension of the king, the dimension of his opponents in the court, and the third dimension where the ordinary masses, and particularly women, they are watching all these people. Now, the last point about this witches, and then I shift to the earlier focus. The last point is that these women can understand the present very well. They know who is the culprit. In fact, so far as these women are concerned, everybody is the culprit. The king is culprit, his opponents are culprits, and those families with the structures, you know, which have ousted them, maybe they lost their husbands early, maybe their sons and daughters did not take care of them. This question appears again and again in Shakespeare. I told you with respect to King Lear also. King Lear, as soon as he gave his power to his daughters, then he was shunted out. And he had to live like a beggar, you know, moving around as a mad person in the country. So these, woman figures in this play, the reminders of King Lear, who was the king himself. So anyway, these people are able to see reality properly. Now, if you think of who sees India's reality properly, then I would suggest to you that the ordinary masses see the reality of India much better than, and they can also prophesy. They can always, you know, anticipate, that they can tell you what's going to happen to a certain extent. They may be wrong, but who knows, maybe they are right. And so far as these women are concerned, the entire plot in the play has been unfolded according to the predictions that these three women made right in the first scene itself. And what did they say in the first scene? They said, fair is foul and foul is fair. Which means the world has gone, wrong topsy-turvy. The world has lost its center. The world doesn't move according to a plan, according to a reason, according to some kind of a moral scheme. So this is what the mental plight of the ordinary masses is in history, and who knows, maybe in the present surroundings also. So we have, coming back to the issues that the play raises, are the power, courtly conflicts, then violence. Violence itself is an issue. Does it solve any problem? Shakespeare will not give an answer, but he will show what consequences occur when there is violence on the stage. And self-centric interests. Macbeth is not bothered about the consequences of killing the king. The king is becoming more and more kind to him. Maybe the king has his own interest at heart. Maybe the king is trying to exploit Macbeth. That's a different thing. But then this person has the king at his place as a guest. And at night, that guest is murdered. When he has been fed, he has been wined and dined, the murder is planned very well by both husband and wife, the host and the hostess. So people believe in violence. Then there are self-centric interests. Macbeth has this temptation, has this particular ambition of becoming the king, and everything else follows from that particular ambition. Then the ruthless pursuit of the interests. They don't bother about morality. So morality is nice to talk about, morality is nice to preach about, but when it comes to actual action, then one follows the self-centric interests. Then you want to promote yourself. If this is the world, and Shakespeare, that's why Shakespeare is so very inspiring and appealing even today. Even today we don't think of the larger interest in life. We only think of ourselves, then our smaller family, and then of something else, if there is time for that. And most of us will agree that we have no time for anything, giving it to our own self, our own promotion, and the promotion of our children. So these self-centric ideals and interests, they also come for criticism in this particular play, not through any kind of preaching, but through the showing of, exhibition of the pursuit, which is naked and ruthless. Then on the other side, these are the negative aspects of concern. The positive aspects are loyalty. Loyalty, against the background of loyalty, is the protagonist found guilty. Then innocence. There are innocent children killed in the play because they might, later on become, contenders to the throne, etc. So they have to be killed at that point of time. And then, nature. Nature is a participant in all these things. The women, move around in nature. So some fights happen in nature. Later on, when Macbeth is to be resisted by the people, and by the armies of the other force, then and he's a good fighter and he's a good commander of forces. It's not easy to defeat him. Then I particularly refer to Shakespeare didn't have that kind of wherewithal, that kind of factors to present on the stage. He could not present, for instance, a war on the stage, a battle on the stage, but cinema can. And I saw in Kurosawa's film rendering of this play that the soldiers went to the forests and they tied branches of the trees around their bodies, and they started walking. And Kurosawa showed as if the forest itself had become a kind of an army, and the forest was attacking the habitation in the town which is occupied by Macbeth. So nature is important here. Now nature has two aspects. One aspect is trees and clouds and rain and thunder and all those things, and there are continuous references to these things in the play. So when the murder is happening, then there is a different kind of a sky, there is a different kind of stars, the moon goes in one corner and there is darkness all around. That is what nature is. And when it comes to the other aspect of nature, what is that? What is the other aspect of nature which is different from trees and floods and rivers and mountains, etc.? That is inside us. We are human beings also as natural beings. We have the natural tendencies in us. They work at the level of behavior. We are supposed to become aware of them. If we are not able to control them, then they'll start controlling us. So inside us also there is nature. For instance, there is the flow of blood in our bodies, there are muscles in us, there is a brain in us. All these things relate to nature. They evolved from nature, and Shakespeare is referring to the inbuilt ambition, the inbuilt sense of competition, the inbuilt interest in oneself, and the conscious control, the conscious morality, the conscious aspect of reason. This has a kind of a tussle with nature, which is the inner and the submerged tendencies in us. So the aspect of nature cannot be overlooked, cannot be ignored, and we have that here. Then innocence, nature, loyalty, these are the things that range against interests and their ruthless pursuit and conflicts and all those things. And from the beginning till the end of the play, we are weighing the pros and cons. We are going to into these aspects, and then we are translating them into a different set of interests that surround us in actual life, and then a different kind of a conflict begins in the course of our studying of the play. Will stability finally come on the scene? Is the question that confronts us in the play, that things are unstable, things are uncertain, and ground has moved away from beneath our feet, and we don't know where to place ourselves. We don't feel firm at all. We don't have that kind of reassurance. Will order finally come back? Is the question. Well, in the play, when it ends, some kind of an order has come back. But what kind of an order? One doesn't know who the king is, what kind of the king one is, whether another Macbeth is already in the making. After 20 years, Macbeth will stand up again. Shakespeare goes into it, suggests this, and finds no answer. And because he finds no answer, that's how it's a tragedy. If there were an answer to this, then this play would finally end up as a folk tale, and there is a moral of the story. This is what the work suggests. But here there's no answer, because there's no reference to any stable answer in the play. And if you think that in Shakespeare's time there's any stable answer, then you have to consult history, and you will find that there is no stable answer there, at least for the moment. I keep discussing, bringing in this aspect also. Today I won't repeat. But then in 1604 or 5, when the play is composed and presented, or even later for some time, there seems to be no answer. Of course, the answer is there, but that no answer is not seen by Shakespeare at that point of time in the concrete crystallized form. Okay. Then I come to the, I have just a few minutes left now, and I would like to talk briefly about certain other points. The basic argument about this play being a humanist document, that argument, as far as I'm concerned, has been already made somewhat clear for your appreciation. Are these witches, are they actual? I go back to it. And why is Shakespeare, not being clear about them? Because Shakespeare does not want to mystify anything. Shakespeare wants to use mystery in order to throw light on certain aspects of life. He doesn't want to give the answers. He compels us to think about the problem and then a possible answer. So there is an element of magic, and there is an element of unreality, and there is an element of confusion in the play, and that confusion is very well used by Shakespeare. And for instance, I've written here to share this idea that the witches are there and not there. They appear and do not appear. They are ghosts and not ghosts. They are ideas and not ideas. They are actual reality. And as feminists point out, they are the social discards. They are women who have no role to play. And if they have no role to play, then they'll definitely predict only evil things, because they have confronted evil things in their own life. And regarding this nature, that is the point that is to be further established, that nature doesn't somehow, whether it's our nature inside us or whether it's the nature around, it doesn't want any kind of violence. If there is violence, then nature will find an answer to it. That answer, maybe evolved over a period of time. Maybe nature will intervene after 100 years, but nature does intervene. And if you think about today's time, then you realize that environment is coming back to us. Environment is giving its own threats. If you disturb nature, even the outer nature, then it comes back with earthquakes, it comes back with floods, it comes back with all kinds of rise and fall in temperature and things like that. So this question is touched upon because human beings are a part of nature, and they are a participant in natural activities, and they also work against the interests of nature. So this particular dimension of nature is clearly formulated in the play at the level of the conduct of the characters in it. And if you think of the audience of Shakespeare's time, then you realize that they would go into the fine points of this. Now this is the point that particularly has to be discussed in this context, that Shakespeare's audience is able to understand the dilemmas of people like Macbeth. We cannot, not so easily. So maybe we are literarily, ideologically, and morally less literate than the Elizabethan audience. We can't produce a Shakespeare today. Now, that kind of balance, that kind of insight into the behaviors of human beings that Shakespeare is to offer, we cannot offer. Partly because Shakespeare goes into the aspects of all these things with an objective eye. And we have our subjectivities which create hurdles for us. So Shakespeare's audience, in fact, compelled him to write plays of a very high intellectual kind. So when you read this play, and when you read particularly the inner tussle of the mind of characters, for instance, in this play, like in Hamlet, there are certain soliloquies. What are soliloquies? Soliloquies are characters on the stage being alone and talking to themselves. That's what a soliloquy is. And there are soliloquies in the play. Macbeth, is alone on the stage and he's asking a question from himself. And the way he's asking the question, that, reveals his own mind. And Macbeth is able to share his dilemmas with the audience of that time. Those dilemmas give us a psychological dimension, a moral dimension, an ideological dimension. Are Shakespeare's audiences interested in knowing these dimensions? My answer is yes. Otherwise, Shakespeare would not talk about them. So Shakespeare's audiences are very alert. They might be literate. There were no schools and colleges at that time, barring one or two universities in England at that point of time. And yet, when people came to the stage, people came to the theater and they watched Shakespeare's plays, then they would with rapt attention they would see and hear the scene unfolding before them, and they'll appreciate. And this play is known for its high poetic content. This play is known for its, you know, high, you know, intellectual and analytical interest. It goes into the very layers of the mind of the person. It talks about, you know, sensibilities and sensitivities, you know, the way a human being is formed at the level of the mind. How will the person react? There is a moral question. How will Macbeth sort out this moral question in his own mind? He's talking about immorality. And in fact, he says again and again that I know what is right, but I'm being pushed in the opposite direction. So how come, you know, that a person is being pushed in the opposite direction? It means his reason is not strong enough. In fact, I also attended a workshop in which there was a director, and he was telling, you know, us participants to enact a certain scene from Macbeth. And the scene was, if it is done, then something happens. If it is not done, then something else happens. So the director asked some of us to come forward and say, okay, now you go to that corner. And a person was asked to stop us. So we were wrestling, you know, with certain characters. We were walking towards the door, and somebody would stop us from going towards the door. And then the director told us that this is exactly what is happening in Macbeth's mind. He wants to commit murder, and he doesn't want to commit murder. So there is a force inside him which is stopping him. Now Shakespeare is able to present it in the form of language. So you read the language, you read the soliloquy, you read what he is saying to himself. He wants to go and he cannot go, and he has to go. Now see the kind of paradox, and that paradox is built in the very structure of the human mind. In fact, in all of us, it's not easy to commit a murder. It's not easy to tell a lie, but we tell lies. And how do we tell lies? First, we convince ourselves that telling a lie is important for our personal progress. And there's nothing more important than personal progress. If I have to promote the interest, I must promote the interest of my children. And if somebody asks, why your children? What about the neighbor's children? Aren't they your children? Then my answer is, no. They are those parents' children. So I should promote the interest of my children. Somebody else should promote the interest of their own children. So this kind of a clash occurs. And Shakespeare raises the question. And in fact, if he's a humanist, then he will say, well, you can't differentiate between children. All children are in fact products of society in general, and you can't separate yourself from others. So this is the kind of, you know, thing that I want to, so far as this play is concerned, I want to go into this question of Macbeth committing a murder which he doesn't approve of. So how come it happens? And Shakespeare goes into the very nature of the human conflict that is there in the mind of this person. So the last question is with respect to the characters in the play. Macbeth, a male, a person with ambition, and a person who is, you know, requesting his wife to join him, to assist him so that he can get his ambition fulfilled. And the wife, you know, comes to him, and there is another hypocrisy that is seen in the play. And that hypocrisy is that Macbeth has prepared his wife to support him. And when she supports him, then he says, well, I'm feeling guilty. I think I should not do it. Then the wife says, you damned fool. You must come forward now. You have already prepared me mentally. And now that I'm there, ready to help you, at that point of time, you are developing cold feet. So this kind of thing is there in Shakespeare. And the woman is stronger. I would have, in fact, appreciate Lady Macbeth more than Macbeth, because she's fighting not her own battle. She's fighting her husband's battle. So she is in a way, being loyal to her husband, which is much better than the man who is pursuing his own interests. He never asked his wife to tell him the correct advice. He asked her to join him. And if the woman joined him, then he says he is trying to, impress her by his moral conflict. So see the hypocrisies that the males have, unlike the females, who will be more consistent and more strong. So in fact, some critics have argued that at the level of character, Lady Macbeth is a stronger, is a more rational, is a more convincing character than Macbeth himself. So Shakespeare's sympathies lie, if at all they have to lie with a murdering duo, then they lie with Lady Macbeth and not with Macbeth. So she is shown as, she sleepwalks in the play towards the end, and then she doesn't know whom she is talking to. So she is very deeply afflicted at the level of the mind. She has done something wrong. She has blood on her hands, and she has ceased to be herself at that point of time. Then you have this Banquo, this person who was a friend, with Macbeth, And when the prophecy came, then he also was involved. So his children will be, one of the children will become a king, and this Banquo also was taken up with, this particular lie, this particular prophecy, and he became a party to Macbeth's schemes. So should we blame him? Should we not blame him? I think he's equally a participant in murder, because he also has an ambition. And his ambition is of a very weird kind. He will not become king himself, even according to the prophecy. He'll become only his children. One of the children will become a king. So he's interested in getting the son, getting the king murdered by another person and his wife, so that his child can become the king later. What kind of nonsense is going on? Shakespeare would raise this question on the stage for the benefit of the audience. So this is what Banquo is, and Duncan, so far as the king is concerned, who is murdered and all, we don't know much about him. He dies in the at the end of the first scene, or just the first act, or just the second act, and in the second act particularly. But then Duncan is actually governing, is controlling over a court where everybody is a self-seeker. So how is he able to establish balance? So he must be a very intelligent king. And when he is kind, do you think he is kind because he is genuine, or because he has certain interest to serve himself? A king is never ever loyal, disloyal, or what. A king is only interested in keeping the country stable under his control. That's what Shakespeare would say. So it means that the king, the kings, the courtiers, the noblemen, the upper classes in society, all of them are hand in glove with one another, and they are trying to control the resources of the country as a whole. So if that is the case, then Duncan is no less, crime oriented than these people. And all these things have to be taken in some kind of a consonance, so that one has a true picture of human behavior coming before us through this play. So, friends, if there is something that Unnati would like to comment on, Unnati, would you say something on this?
Yes. So, with this lecture, I am getting a lot of insights about the times during which Shakespeare wrote his play. Mm-hmm. And when you tell that all these plays are based on the folklores, mm-hmm. it suggests that folklores always have impression on the people. Mm-hmm. And this impressionability, and how intricately he builds it around the Scottish reign, mm-hmm. makes me wonder, is it fiction or is it non-fiction? Mm-hmm. And also another aspect, that Shakespeare had a theatre company, mm-hmm. and the plays were being enriched very dynamically with the audience. Mm-hmm. So with the development of audience intellect, the plays got enriched. And as you pointed out, that the people were able to understand the level of psyche and turmoil existing within the characters, which were not always good or bad.
I'm glad you have understood at that level. It's very true, and the question of fact and fiction, getting mixed up in Shakespeare. This is the crux of the matter, and I think you have understood it quite well. Any comment that you'd like to make?
So I just want Gitika? To say that if we talk about that era or this era, greed, which is a negative desire, always give rise to the evil practices. That is a negative action. So one should always try to get rid of this negative desire, that is greed. As I could only say that we can definitely quote that as you sow, so shall you reap. That was all in the Macbeth, if I'm not wrong. Mm-hmm. And this is what I can say.
This is called in literary criticism discourse. This is a kind of developed attitude that is there in the play, and this is an important factor in the play. This is highlighted also quite well by the playwright, so that we are compelled to think about the consequences, the implications of such discourses as we talked about. So this is how, and
time is not permitting us to talk a lot, to talk more, though we wanted to talk more and more, as your lectures are always very interesting. But with this note, we would like to say you thanks, as well as I give my sincere thanks to Dr. Unnati for giving her expert comments, I would say. And thank you, sir. Thank you so very much. We would be meeting again, and we would be discussing more on the Macbeth's creations in our future sessions. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.